Exciting news, ladies. You are officially invited. Yes, you're invited to join us in Fertility Awareness Mastery Live. This is my 10-week group coaching program designed to help you gain confidence using fertility awareness. Whether you're actively avoiding pregnancy or looking to optimize your cycles for conception, we have a spot for you. We start the third week of September. Are you ready to jump in? Head over to fertilityfriday.com/fam, F-A-M, to register today. That's fertilityfriday.com/fam. This is the Fertility Friday podcast, episode number 381. Welcome to the Fertility Friday podcast, your source for information about the fertility awareness method and all things fertility. I'm your host, Lisa Hendrickson-Jack. I'm the author of The Fifth Vital Sign and the Fertility Awareness Mastery Charting Journal. I'm a certified fertility awareness educator and holistic reproductive health practitioner with nearly 20 years of experience teaching women to connect to their fifth vital sign through menstrual cycle charting, balancing hormonal health, and optimizing the menstrual cycle without hormones. I'm outspoken about hormonal birth control and its impact on fertility and overall health because you have the right to know how your body works and how artificial hormones disrupt that natural process. I host live coaching programs to help you achieve optimal fertility and health because it's important to have healthy menstrual cycles regardless of whether or not you want to have babies. I'm also a wife and mother of two beautiful boys. I know, I'm a busy girl, but I managed to fit it all in. This podcast is designed to empower you to take full control of your cycles, your fertility, and your overall health. And I'm so excited that you're here with us today. Today, I'm sharing another episode in my Fertility Awareness Reality Series. I'm sharing my interview with Meg, who was a member of my most recent Fertility Awareness Mastery Live group program. And in our interview, we talked about Meg's transition point, you know, when she made that decision to transition off hormonal contraceptives to fertility awareness-based method, i.e. a non-hormonal method, and kind of what prompted her to do that and how that shift affected her body and kind of how she came to the decision that it felt right for her. Of course, given that I teach fertility awareness charting, the vast majority of real on-air client sessions that you hear are for women who chose to come off birth control, right? Like that's kind of one of the precursors to using fertility awareness as your primary method of birth control. But it's really interesting to listen to. I mean, if you were to listen to a lot of these episodes kind of back to back, for any of you who may be newer to the podcast, you can head over to fertilityfriday.com/FAM reality. So fertilityfriday.com/FAM and the word reality, and you'll see all of the previous on-air client sessions. And so you can kind of hear just the differences between different women in terms of how they approach it. So for some women, they kind of learn about fertility awareness and jump in because they're really intrigued by it and they just really want to learn more about their body. For others, they're having some, you know, moderate and in some cases severe side effects that they're trying to figure out. Sometimes they know that it's related to birth control, sometimes they don't. So for some women, it's more of an urgent kind of issue where they're actually having negative experience on birth control. But for many women, it's literally just kind of like a shift. They just want to learn more about their bodies, have a deeper understanding. I get a lot of messages from women who discover the podcast and it's all new to them. And it's kind of like, holy cow, there's this whole world that's happening that I had no idea about. I just think for a lot of us, we just gravitate to it for that reason. And I know it was the same for me. So for me, it was this just amazement. And I was in awe in terms of how much I didn't know about my body. And it was like this really cool, just insight, deeper insight that I could learn and gain into what's happening in my own body. And I really just didn't want to miss out on that. I was like, this is awesome. Like, you know, why didn't they teach everybody this? Of course I want to do this. But everybody isn't necessarily at the same point. So what I always say is that fertility awareness charting isn't necessarily for everybody or for every single period of everybody's life. So for some women, they're going to just jump in. And of course, but for others, there might be a season, a certain point in their life where fertility awareness feels like the best option, whereas there's other points in their lives where it may not be the best option. So with all that being said, let's go ahead and jump into my conversation with Meg. I'm excited to be here today with Meg. Meg is a member of my most recent Fertility Awareness Mastery Live group program, and we just literally finished. So we're recording this actually just minutes after we had our last session. So welcome to the show, Meg.
Thank you for having me. I know it was bittersweet saying goodbye to everyone, but I knew I was coming on here after so I could keep the conversation rolling, which I was excited about because it is a very wonderful space that you create where you can just kind of share things that you don't really have people to talk to about sometimes. So it's a really nice space to have. So I really appreciate the class.
Oh, thank you. Yeah, I love when I'm able to have sessions after the last session because it kind of feels like it's not over and we can still hang out a little bit. And also it's a very interesting space. It would be so interesting if we could do it in person, but it's such an interesting space. For me, it's what I do. So I do this kind of all the time, but I always have to step back and think about what it really is because there's few places on earth that you can get together and talk about all of the intimate details of your vagina, really, for lack of a better.
So, funny story of my own, basically, I mean, this has become my world, so I can even do my background a little later, but I found that I love this whole how your body works, and everything I hear from you or different books I was reading, it was kind of like, why doesn't everybody know this? So when I end up with people that are like-minded, I kind of have the same conversation with them. And since we've been in this course, this kind of comes up. So I was getting my hair done the other day and my hair lady is like really on our page. So we're just talking, like chatting about your cervix. And she's like, is this a weird thing that happened? I'm like, this is your hair salon. And I was like, we can do whatever you want. I talk about this all the time. So it's just like, you find the people, they want to talk about it. So it's good to just get the conversations going.
Yeah, that's hilarious. And so true. I mean, I've been less social this year for a number of reasons, but before that, because of the weird world, but before all of that, when I would be out, I mean, I don't really go on about what I do, but if asked, I will say it, what I do, right? So then when someone asks me, it's like what I do, it's like, and then there's a huddle of women around me asking about their periods. And it's just, yep. it's the greatest thing. Well, but with that said, I'd love to give an opportunity just for you to share a little bit about yourself. So of course, on this podcast, How We Roll, I love asking the question of how old were you when you had your first period? And let us know kind of what brought you to this point. So what were your cycles like? Have you used hormonal contraceptives before? And what led you to choose fertility awareness now?
Sure. So lots there to unpack. What's funny is I kind of have this like early Meg versus current Meg that I like to go between. I do a lot of studying with like astrology. And so I'm a Scorpio. I kind of relate that to things. So my early Meg story, really in that Scorpio, which is like a very secretive energy, had my first period around, I think like 14. And I remember I was on vacation visiting some cousins in South Carolina. So I'm with my mom and my sister. And I don't know what it is about me, but I was like, nope, we're going to pretend this isn't going on. You kind of like see red there. It's a nice sunny day outside. I'm like, we're just going to pretend this isn't happening and just probably shove some toilet paper there. You're like, this will be fine. And I kind of go out throughout the day. Just, I don't even know why. It's just inherently, I didn't want to talk about it. It must be the way it was even brought up around us. I mean, when we learn about it in school, it's very on the down low. It's not like something to celebrate, which is really what I want to help turn the world around and actually teach people. It's really cool and helpful and celebrate it. But I just kind of like went through the whole day till the point where I was like, okay, I can't really do this anymore. I need to tell them. And my family's amazing. So I don't even know why I'm hiding it from them. And so, you know, my mom's making a big thing to my sister. Oh, guess what? She's with us. And you know, gives me whatever I need, pad or tampon. And I'm like, okay, here we are. Like it's begun. So I always had kind of like lighter periods, no real big problems. Didn't really pay much attention to it. And then I was around like, I guess it was 18 or so going to college, had a boyfriend. Naturally, the gynecologist teamed up with my mom, who was at the time supportive of it too, saying, sure, the pill sounds like a great plan. And who am I to know any different? Sounds great. Go on it. And I actually didn't have too many like noticeable reactions at that time. So I was on it for a while. So it was basically 10 years, pretty much the same pill. Nothing really changed. And I would say, I guess it was like, so I came off of it in 2019. So it was basically 2009 to 2019. So 18 to 28 years old. And I don't know, it was again, kind of this astrology theme around, you have a Saturn return, which is like the planet Saturn comes back to where it was when you were born. And it's a lot of times it's a big deal in people's lives. People get married, they have children, they change their jobs, just things happen. For whatever reason, this was the time, I didn't even know this at the time. It's not like I'm planning it based on astrology, but I just knew in my body, I was like, I need to just, I'm done with the pill. I gotta be off of it. Over the years, I'd check in every now and then with the little booklet reading, like, what is this doing to my body? But like, didn't really know what was happening. Or I have conversations with my girlfriends and we'd be like, so we have like a ton of eggs now, right? Like they're just piling up. And we're like, sure, probably. Like we just had no idea what was going on. But I just knew, I was like, I'm over. We're done with this. So kind of came off of it cold turkey and then got my period back pretty much, like skipped a month, but then got it back the next month. And it seemed like it was fine. It's going to regulate itself. Then things started to kind of come to light where I realized I actually was very imbalanced in many different ways, with a hormone imbalance and some insulin resistance. And basically one day I just realized, well, I had this probably happen two or three times, where I was after breakfast, probably about an hour or so, I felt like I had to sit down. I was lightheaded. My eyelids just needed to close. Like I was going to pass out. I needed to go to sleep for an hour. And that happened like two times. And I had recently become friends with a functional nutritionist and we were meeting just to have a call on Zoom about something else. And she asked me how I was doing. And I was like, honestly, I'm about to pass out on the couch. And she's like, okay. And she asked me, like, rattles off these questions. And she just goes into her practitioner mode. And then I start working with her from there, which has been so great because she's helped me to take some of those tests that you don't get from like a traditional doctor route. Like the Dutch test is one that you get at home. It's a urine test and they just test all your levels of hormones. And I realized I had extremely low levels of cortisol. Like I couldn't get out of bed in the morning, like the flatline level of like, this is your baseline cortisol. I was like hugging the line the whole time. Like I had no big spikes throughout the day. So just knowing I had different imbalances there, I had some like testosterone, like androgens, which is kind of like a pre PCOS sort of marker, just little things that were like, okay, these are off. We need to work on some things. And I did a lot through my diet, my lifestyle changes, and kind of worked on a lot of my emotional body too. So it's been about a year and a half and I felt so much better. I just needed this whole kind of overhaul with the food and the lifestyle. So it's still a work in progress. I have a lot to go over. And that's why this class was like, it came at the right time because I was reading your book. I was reading so many people's books, like Elisa Viti, anything she's ever written, just like Christian Northrup. I love her. So I have every book that's ever written on periods and cycles. And I just knew about what you had taught, fertility awareness method. And I'd hear it over and again. I'm like, okay, well, I know I need something to replace the pill now. What is the option? And I kind of understood it when I listened to your podcast, but not enough to be able to just use it. So then I think I just happened to listen to one. It's obviously perfect timing. I don't know. I'm going somewhere, pick the right podcast. And you're talking about the program starting in like a week or two. And I'm like, okay, I'm free. Let's do it. Sign up. And it was just perfect timing. So I've been kind of rounding up my little journey here of understanding my body and health. So very, very excited about everything you've taught me and putting it to practice.
Awesome. It's so, it's so interesting when I do interviews because you get like the snapshot of someone's life and it's like 3 minutes, but it's like 10 to 15 years of your life. Well, and I wanted to just ask some questions around the time that you came off birth control. I think you probably mentioned it, but what prompted you to come off of it? And then was kind of just like, was the thing with the cortisol just a random thing that happened at that time? Or do you think, because it seems like it was kind of around that time that that happened. Like, what did your functional nutritionist say about that?
Sure. So a couple of things, basically, I guess, like over the 10 years, my mom actually started to point out, like, hey, like, blood clots are a thing on the pill. And I was like, no, you know, then you read the pamphlet and they're like, well, you know, if you're pregnant, you're X amount of times more likely to have a blood clot. So they basically tell you the possible problem, but then they shove the, like, oh, but it's way worse if you're over here type of a solution. So then you go, oh, I'm fine. The doctor pamphlet told me that I'm way more likely to get it in another scenario. So kind of keep pushing that under the rug, but they were persistent and helpful to, my parents were always very much, you know, it's your body, make your choice, but these things are now becoming a concern for us. So it was helpful, but I was at the time, I couldn't hear it. I wasn't ready for it. I was like, this is what I'm going to do. I'm going to stay on it. So those things were in the back of my mind. And I guess I was getting this call more towards natural too. Anyway, like my whole life, I started to get this call to be more towards, I went to the ocean. I used to live in Baltimore. I'm in the United States. And now I moved to New Jersey by the water. And it was just this call to be like, whatever is not natural, let's just kind of get rid of it and go back to square one. But before that, like right before it, so I do think what I've learned in my health journey is that everything compounds on itself over time. So it's not just the pill. It's not just anything else in my life. It was all of it together. So I guess it was probably early 2019, I had this kind of, I guess you would generalize it as IBS, just the umbrella category of something's wrong with your gut, where I would eat something and I just felt horrible. Like my stomach, it was so much pain I'd never felt before. I didn't understand. And I started with this kind of like low FODMAP, cut everything out, bring things back in. I think that's around the time I really realized like caffeine, you're not really good with caffeine. You shouldn't have coffee every day. And I started there and I think I made some good progress, and we were going to Italy actually right when I was doing this whole like low FODMAP thing, and I realized that their gluten there is actually much more tolerable. But I just have this one picture, we were in Bellagio, we're in northern Italy, and I had a bar from America, an energy bar before we went. And I was like, this is the biggest regret I've ever had. Cause then I had lasagna there, which was great, but it was the energy bar, whatever was in it. Cause it was more not natural material, natural ingredients. I was bending over, my sister's trying to like buy a purse and asking my opinion. I'm like, I don't know. I'm going to die here. And I'm just like leaning over with my stomach. It was just in so much pain. So that was probably an early precursor of like, okay, things are out of balance. What is going on that you're so far out of the range of a normal reaction to food? So that was kind of in my back of my mind. Then it was like, okay, there are side effects to the pill. I don't know. Some whisper was just like, it's time. So I just dropped it. I always felt probably over the last couple years while on the pill that I was always really tired. Like it was always hard for me to wake up. But again, it's like, how far back can I track it? I was on the pill for 10 years. So I think over time, things compiled on top of itself to get to this point of an imbalance with all of my hormones, because it's all so interconnected and it's complex. So I think the pill over the length of time, because I really like the way you describe certain things of having a bucket with a hole in it, that basically the pill can be this bucket that I've had with this hole for 10 years. So if you have a bucket with a small hole for a year, you might lose some stuff. But if over the course of 10 years, if you're not refilling it constantly and getting yourself back to an equilibrium, you just keep depleting and depleting and depleting and go down this disharmony is basically what I think I was in. So yeah, from there, then I did start to recognize what the effects were. My hair started to fall out pretty rapidly, which I always had kind of thin hair anyway, and it's still pretty thin right now, but I've gotten it back to a place where it's growing in better. But that dramatic shift in hormones from that 10 years of that just synthetic estrogen and progesterone trying to get back to the normal, I think a lot kind of happened. So that exacerbated whatever gut thing I had going on. All of the hormone things were just kind of swirling around, and it was this perfect storm. So I could get someone to be like, okay, we actually need to pull somebody in, get a new team member to help me figure out what's going on. And my nutritionist has been so amazing. So I can't recommend that more. And learning from your class is like, it's so hard to get the right amount of protein, especially for women, when you're working out so much or doing things, we don't realize how much nutrients we need or we're not getting. And that is a huge effect on your body. So I'm working on that a lot. And I think that that's been very, very helpful.
Awesome. Awesome. It's so interesting as you were talking about it, because I've been working on a writing project. Stay tuned. And over the last couple of weeks, I've been doing some research, more research on birth control. And so I was kind of looking at some of the studies on birth control and gut issues and how there is a link between I'm not saying this is what you had, but there's a link between irritable bowel diseases and contraceptives. So it seems like if you're generally at risk for it and you're using birth control, or if you had that issue and you're using it, or, you know, even if you were susceptible to it, it can exacerbate it. And then we know it can disrupt the gut flora, the microbiota balance. And so it's interesting to kind of think about it, because for most of us, these are kind of intangible things. It's kind of like just picking at us. And like you said, it can take some time to really shine in a bad way. And there was, of course, I had to address what you said about the pamphlet and how it talks about the risk of blood clots and stroke and compares it to pregnancy. That's something that in one of my writing projects, I was looking at, because when you, for any, all of the researchers out there, or the kind of nerds in the category like I am, when you actually research this whole thing with contraceptives and the pill, it's almost like there's a rule, if you're submitting research, that you have to say the party line. And the party line, like, I'm not even making this up. Like, if anyone's looked into the research, you've seen it yourself. But it's like there's certain things that it's like they have to say it together in order to be published. And one of those things would be that they directly compare a woman's risk of this, a stroke or other kind of cardiovascular severe risk factors, to pregnancy. And it's bizarre, because they're basically saying that you're either on the pill or pregnant. And so therefore the pill is great, because since you're not pregnant, like, it's actually a lower risk than when you're pregnant. And I'm thinking, pregnancy is a natural state. You're not pregnant all the time. First of all, you're not perpetually pregnant. And second of all, if you're not on the pill, it doesn't mean automatically that means that you're going to be pregnant or forever. And so, like, most women aren't actually pregnant their whole lives. So you wouldn't have this constant increased risk of stroke. And anyways,
so no, I love that too. I don't know why I was thinking about that recently, but it is, it's kind of like, sure, like this medicine that you do not have to take under any circumstances has caused people to die, but it's okay because there's something else out in the world that causes more people to die usually. And you're like, well, that's not reasonable, rational thought that I want to be using when I'm just taking this medicine just for this one thing that I don't need to have it for. And I'm just like, they just rationalize it in a way that's irrational. And it makes you laugh.
Yeah, it's crazy. I won't devolve too much, but it makes me think. So when I was looking at those studies, there was a study that was talking, and I haven't looked at it for a minute, so it's not like I'm quoting it directly or anything, but basically, based on their numbers and their information, they were saying that it was something like 300 to 350, or somewhere between 300 and 400 women die annually in the States from blood clots and stroke. And so in the research study, they were like, it's equivalent to a jumbo jet crashing every year of women who die. So obviously there's like hundreds of millions of people in the States. So it's not like your risk of dying technically is like 1 in 10 or something like that. It's relatively low, but still, it shouldn't be controversial for us to talk about it and acknowledge it and address it. And exactly what you said, it is something that you're taking that you could opt not to take. There are other ways to manage your fertility. Obviously, if the listeners are here at the Fertility Friday podcast, right? So there are other ways to manage your fertility that don't come with the risk of death.
Exactly. No, that's what I like is the way you phrase it, because it is, it's like they always put it in this percentage number or one out of X number, and you make it think like, oh, one out of X, that's not a lot. But if you put the number of 300 and something people, that's just telling you 300 people have taken this and died. I'd actually like someone to tell me that up front. Annually. And so it's like, what if, I forget what podcast I listened to, but I love this. I listened to a million related to this topic, but a guy, I guess, was on it whose daughter, I think, had taken the pill and died from a blood clot. So he's on a crusade to just inform people. But I like the way he said it was, my goal is not to get rid of it, because I'm all about, and he was all about, women's choice. It's great. It's done a lot for women. It's let people go to college, and it's just been very helpful in that regard. But like cigarettes, I want it to be known what the risk factors are when you're taking it, because it's kind of handed to you like, it's fine. Here you go. Do your own research if you want to. It's like,
it's a vitamin. It's like vitamin C. Just take it.
Let's just hand a bunch of 18-year-old cigarette packets and just say, go do your own research. And it's like, no, a little more info would be helpful. So that is kind of what I found out how passionate I was about it after I came off of it, after I realized what it was doing to my body, and only understanding that after the fact, which was so interesting. Spent 10 years on it, didn't know what was happening, came off of it. Now I know what was happening for the most part. But then you do the research and you're like, I actually still don't know exactly how it works. Like, I was going to ask you this. So, I mean, basically you're getting a neutral level of synthetic estrogen and progesterone. So it's the same level of hormones throughout the month until you take those placebo pills, but you're basically getting no hormones. So I understand the cycle now where you need estrogen to build up the lining so that you can then bleed. So since this is such a neutral level, like what, I know the bleed is more of a, like a withdrawal bleed is what they call it. So it's not a real period, but how does that even happen? Like there's not, how does enough get built up to even have a endometrial lining to bleed?
Well, that's a great question. Let me think about how, cause there's a couple things, right? Cause of course I could talk about this all day. I think the first thing to mention, of course, is that they use the word estrogen and progesterone because we're familiar with those words, but they're synthetic versions of them. One of my mentors called them like alien hormones because, so if you eat soy contains like phytoestrogens, meaning plant-based estrogens, but soy is like, it's a plant, like it's found in nature. So what they put into the pill, it's not found in nature. Because you can't patent things and make money if you find it in nature. So what you have to do is modify it so that you can put your name on it and like legally own it so that you can sell it, right? So that's the first thing I think is really important. So it's synthetic estrogens and progestins that are in these, and they're not the same as our natural hormones. And so that means that although they have similar effects, they don't have the exact same effects. And so that in and of itself is an interesting thing that I'll let all the listeners ponder. So what it's doing essentially, because what's interesting is that you're taking these synthetic hormones, but technically you would still be making your own hormones. So by taking these synthetic hormones, your natural production of estrogen and progesterone is significantly decreased. And what, when I was young, and I think most women today, what I was told was like, oh, it's like it makes your body think you're pregnant. Mm-hmm. So pregnancy is a natural state. That is actually not like being on the pill. When you compare a woman's natural hormones when they're on hormonal contraceptives, it's more comparable to that of a woman in menopause. Because if you think about it, what is menopause? You know, menopause is when your ovaries are essentially in a state of rest. So they're not really producing significant, but they produce a little bit of hormones still. So legit early chemical menopause, right? But that's not going to sound good for the marketing. Right. So they don't really go there, but that's essentially what's happening. And so what happens is that when you're taking there's all the different kinds, we won't get into that, but like the regular pill is like a synthetic version of a combined estrogen, synthetic estrogen and progestin. And so it essentially suppresses ovarian function. So there's three kind of main modes of action. The primary mode of action is suppressing ovulation. So for the most part, you for the most of the time wouldn't be ovulating, or at least the majority of that ovulatory function would be suppressed. Another factor is that, so you have the synthetic estrogen and progestin, and so it does obviously cause some degree of uterine lining development, but the uterine lining for women who are taking it when they measure it with ultrasound is quite thin. So it's thinner than what is needed in order to sustain a pregnancy. So that's another mode of action. So the uterine lining is thin and flat. So even if by somehow, you know, an egg got through, the chances of it implanting would be very low. And then the third mode of action is actually preventing the cervix from preventing fertile quality cervical fluid. So now that you're charting, you can kind of attest, like when you were on the pill, you probably didn't see any mucus because mm-hmm. there wouldn't have been any because you would have basically been in that like post, you know, if we want to compare it to a natural state, you'd be in that post-ovulatory dry kind of state the whole time that you're on it. And so that's primarily how it works. And to answer your question about the, like, how do you have a period and that kind of stuff? So interestingly, and I've told the story a lot, I'm not sure how much I've told it on this podcast, but when they first designed the pill, the first beta version, I always call it the beta test. So the pill came out in 1960. So the beta test took place, you know, the years before that. And so when they first designed it, they didn't have a sugar pill week or a sugar pill period of time. And so the women were just put on it continuously. And so they stopped menstruating. And so the women thought they were pregnant because this was like the 1950s where there was no pills. And so if you stopped menstruating, it either meant you were pregnant, breastfeeding, or probably sick. So they literally like completely were convinced that they were pregnant. And the doctors couldn't even convince them otherwise. But when the doctors finally got through to them, some of the women were actually quite devastated because some of the women who were taking part of the trials were doing this thing where they were kind of like taking the pill for a while and then it was supposed to trigger their fertility or something like that. So not all the women in the trials were actually actively trying to avoid pregnancy, ironically enough.
Weird.
Yeah. So long story short, you know, the makers of the pill decided, you know, they had this brilliant idea to add in the sugar pill days so that they would cause a bleed. So essentially you have this synthetic hormone soup suppressing your natural ovulatory function, and it builds the lining up to a certain point, obviously. And then once they withdraw it, once they take it away, your body kind of resets. So you shed the blood. And then if you didn't continue to take, like if you just stopped it completely, then eventually you would ovulate, right? Because your body's trying to get back to normal. So that's essentially what's happening.
That's crazy. It is. It's because it's like you're constantly fooling your body. And yeah, how long is it okay to be messing with the natural rhythm of your body is really the question that kind of kept coming up for me on a daily basis after the fact, after I did it for 10 years. But it's like, wow, look at what I did. And now with all this research that I've been doing, learning what just ovulating for your, what it means to your body, for your future health, for your bone health and brain health and all that, they don't tell you that that's also a factor. Not only does the pill itself have some side effects, but also the fact that you're not ovulating has some side effects for your future health. So all of this information, I just think is so great to get out there for people, because the sooner you know, the sooner you can just pay attention and realize like, okay, yeah, I do have some weird stomach thing going on that I didn't always have, or because there's a lot of symptoms that people don't realize are attributed to the pill. Like there's some statistic that you're 1 in 3% more likely to, not 3%, 1 out of 3 people who were not diagnosed with depression beforehand, now that they're on the pill, are depressed. And then they give them an antidepressant to just compound on top of your pill. It's like the pills keep piling up. So just knowing that any pill you have has side effects and just noticing how that feels for your body, like really understanding what your body is telling you, has been just huge for me in the last year, taking the time to listen to yourself.
Yeah, it's crazy. So we've like, I feel like we're kind of hanging out in the tangent because we're talking about the pill. So there's one more thing I want to say about it. So when you were talking about the gentleman whose daughter had passed away, and he was kind of saying like, okay, so we should be looking at this similar to cigarettes. So what's interesting, so when I wrote The Fifth Vital Sign, I compared it because for those of you who don't know, the pill has a black box warning. And so, you know, I think if not all, most of the hormonal contraceptive options have a black box warning. And the reason that they have that is because of what we just talked about with the jumbo jet, like, because there are women who take this medication as directed and die. And so that's what makes it so that it has a black box warning. And so I wrote that. And when my editor looked at it, she told me that she actually went and like looked it up because she was like, she had no idea that it actually had this black box warning. And she's like, oh my gosh, you're right. I had no idea. And I was like, yeah.
It's a known carcinogen. It's like on the list of known carcinogens too now. It's like, these things should probably be literally bigger on the box. Like, right? Like, let's have, you know, like the picture of the alcohol bottles now that have like a lady that's pregnant with an X through it. Like, I feel like we're somewhere around there. That label should start to be printed out. This is my crusade because I went through it. So I feel like I want to share, but I do know everyone's at a different part on their journey, but I just want people to know, right? So it's just knowing maybe you're on it for a little while and just knowing that's fine, but just pay attention to some of the warning signs and know that you have these other options available. But I agree. That's why I love talking about these things. And that's why I love your podcast, because truly it is like, I'll turn on your podcast or someone else's and I'll be like talking in the car too. Like I'm there. So
ridiculous. Yeah. Well, and the thing too is, so when you talk about this stuff, there's at least one person listening right now that's really agitated because it's like, this isn't in context and you're going to dissuade women from using it. It's an effective, it's a quote, safe and effective method of birth control. It's proven. We know it. You know, the chance of dying is very small. And so people get real thorny about having these kinds of conversations. Mm-hmm. And I find it all to be very interesting, because ultimately we should be able to talk about this. We can say, oh, the risk is small and et cetera, but there are people who lost their like 19-year-old daughters, and that's their one daughter. Like, so it might seem like a small thing. And so, of course, everyone who takes the pill isn't going to drop dead, like, obviously. But I feel like we need to talk about it. So last thing, like, because honestly, so at very least, we should be able to talk about the things that would potentially cause you to have a higher risk of something like a stroke, since we have brought it up. When I was interviewing doctors, I've interviewed a number of doctors, and what I've gathered is that often in medical school, doctors are trained about kind of like the quote, higher risk categories. So the higher risk categories are women over 35 who smoke. And if they're on the pill, the doctors are a little bit more on top of it because they're trained to be. But when we're seeing women in their 20s dying, I mean, that means that there are other risk factors that apply that aren't the same. And so these women are kind of being missed. And so smoking is always a factor. The research shows that, but also migraine with aura. So this is another hill that I'll die on. But for anyone listening, you know, again, this isn't about scaremongering. It's, you know, it came up, so I'm just going there, right? But it's really important. There are women who take the pill right now. They say there's an estimated 100 million women on the pill. So there are women who take the pill who, while on the pill, experience severe migraines with aura. And I looked it up today. They say aura can be a visual thing where you see spots or you see flashes. It can be a verbal thing where you actually start slurring your words. Essentially, it's a sensory disturbance. If you have migraine with aura when you're on the pill, you have a significant, a higher chance of dying of a stroke. If you also smoke, the risk is really high. I think they said it was like sevenfold, because I was looking at a study today. So just coincidentally enough. But yeah, that's the takeaway. It's like, we should just be aware of the risks. We should know some of those specific factors that could make us in a greater risk category. And if you are on the pill and you get migraine with aura, you need to talk to your doctor.
Two things that I love about that. One, my new favorite phrase is safe and effective, right? Because I feel like that's being thrown around a lot. And you're like, well, what does safe mean to you when there's different outcomes for different people, right? So
how can we call something safe and effective when like people die every year from using it as directed? Like, how can we just use that statement and just be like, it's safe and effective? Like, I don't understand.
Basically safe and effective means nothing to me.
Mostly safe. Like, I could see like modifying it and say generally recognized as safe, or generally like, but not be just blanket. Yeah, I mean, no, this blanket is semantics, but I'm with you, Meg. Like, no, I'm like not okay with it.
For most things, I don't like the term safe and effective, but to leave it on a very positive note that I like, or just a let's view our life differently note, you were saying, you know, someone might be out there kind of like, oh, it is safe and effective. Like, who are you to take this away from us? Like, one, don't want to take it away from you. Just want to inform you. But two, someone posted recently and I loved it. It was basically like, you are allowed to change your opinion when you've learned something new or when you found out more information. It's like, you don't have to sit there and just be like, oh, I've always felt this way. I always felt that this is what I needed to be for. And then you find out new information and you're like, well, that does sound reasonable, but I'm still here. I'm still angry about this. You're like, no, you're allowed to humbly be like, wow, I might've been wrong because I didn't know that at the time. And that's okay. And it's like, I'm going to just take this new information and where do I go from here? And it's acceptable and beautiful to change yourself. So it's okay. It's okay to not know what you don't know, but now you know. So what are you going to do?
And your only options in life are, you know, incredibly not being on hormonal contraceptives or being pregnant. Like, those are actually not the two states of women, like, in life. There are non-hormonal options that work. They don't work for everybody. And the beauty of life is that we have so many options to suit all of our different personalities and eccentricities.
Exactly. It's very true.
Mic drop, end quote.
I love it.
So with all of that said, I love it. This has been super fun so far. It's time, ladies. Time to take your fertility awareness, knowledge, and confidence to the next level. Just popping into today's episode to invite you to join us for the next round of Fertility Awareness Mastery Live, my 10-week group coaching program that's designed to help you unlock the secrets of your menstrual cycle. Fertility Awareness Mastery teaches you everything you need to know about using fertility awareness cycle tracking to achieve your intentions. Whether you're currently trying to get pregnant, avoiding pregnancy, or planning to conceive in the future, we've got you covered. This program goes deep. Get to the root of your period problems, hormone imbalances, fertility challenges, and so much more. Early bird registration is now open, but only for a limited time. Head over to fertilityfriday.com/fam, F-A-M, to register today. That's fertilityfriday.com/BAM. Now let's go ahead and jump back into today's episode. If you'd like, we can transition into the session part of the session. Mm-hmm. So in our class, we did have a couple hot seats and we had a private session as well. So we've talked about a lot of things, but if there are other things that you'd like to kind of talk about more, we can do a little bit of that today.
Yeah. So, well, first of all, I mean, I've always loved the charting aspect. Like before the class, I did the temperature charting, just that part. And I guess something about the data that I just love, like, I just love looking at it, open it every day and like add stuff to it. I guess I have a Virgo in my chart and it's very like getting things. Oh, okay. You're there. I thought I lost you. It's very much like order and organization and data. It's beautiful. So I like seeing that. And I love seeing the jump when it works out well, which has actually helped me kind of, I already was less drinking less alcohol over time, but when I see how it really affects my temperature in the follicular phase, like before ovulation, I'm like, it's not even worth it. It's not worth having a drink. It's going to throw my temperature off. Like I'm that into it at this point. So, but I do like that you make it so accessible for everybody. You're like, we're not going to be perfect. You wake up at different times and just it is what it is. So I do enjoy that ability to let yourself go. But yeah, for me, the one thing or several things, I'm really working on the whole like cervix position. I think I've got some understanding of it now. It's kind of like you really decide on your own, like, what is this? I don't know. And then you kind of make a guess. So I think it'll take me a couple more rounds to really get my own system down for it. But, you know, sometimes there's people on your podcast, they talk about like the mental block of just like, they don't feel like checking their cervix. Well, I had this whole story that I told you before where I used a Diva cup for a day for the first time and ended up just kind of losing it up there. So I spent a whole day really like trying to get it. And I feel like after that time, like if you want to know what it's like to, or if you want to be like, oh, I don't want to have a mental block of checking my cervix, well, just spend a day just trying to fish around up there. Then you'll be like, oh my God, thank God today all I have to do is check my cervix. I don't have to go on a fishing expedition and then you'll be fine. So I'm really good with that. Just trying to figure out my own charting system for it, but it's getting better. But for me, what we have talked about before is this potential for the cervical dysplasia. So I'm really not having much mucus at all, if any, that I've noticed. And like right now, I think I'm in my ovulatory phase. And so I'm really trying to pay attention, but I haven't seen much. So I do know, like I have an appointment coming up to get things all checked out with a new practitioner. And I'm working with my nutritionist to see about adding that folate in as a supplement. So I think as the months go on, I'll make it my own little plan to get that going. But yeah, for now, I still think I have that kind of dysplasia. So the mucus part isn't really helpful to me at my charting at the moment, but I'm focusing on the temperature and the cervix. And I kind of know once I've gotten past ovulation, it's more like the leading up to ovulation is really the challenging part. But once you get the temperature rise, I get kind of that breast tenderness and kind of mood gets a little different too. So I kind of have that under control of knowing that I've passed it.
Mm-hmm. Well, I mean, for what it's worth. So I have two charts here. And in this chart, most recent one, and you probably have a new one, but in this recent one here, you actually did have a little bit of mucus. It looks like it's around ovulation or maybe just a little bit after, but progress maybe, but it's probably still going to take a little bit of time.
Yeah.
The beauty of, I suppose, the symptothermal method and all the different things that we talked about in the class is that even if one of your signs is not optimal and you're currently working on it, so we've talked about a lot of strategies to get your mucus production up and to kind of sort that all out. And that does take time. It'll take like 3 to 4 cycles likely of dedicated supplement taking and all that kind of stuff. But ultimately you have enough data, even when one of the signs isn't optimal, to still gain that confidence over time. So relying on temperature and cervical position in the meantime. And then also we talked a lot about identifying the last pre-ovulatory infertile day, doing the calculation. And so hopefully you have enough tools to be confident during this transitional phase where you're working on your cervical mucus production.
No, definitely. I think it's been really helpful. And I kind of gave myself this time anyway to just focus on my own health and self so I don't have to like stress and worry about stuff, which has been really helpful. But yeah, I think that it's just really cool that there's several signs to notice. And I don't know. It's just once I learned this, it's very much like, why can't this be part of a general education that everybody knows? Because regardless if you want to use it for birth control, like you should know, because this is my favorite thing, right? So they teach you just like, oh, well, if you have abnormal discharge or anything, that's when you need to see a doctor. It's like, well, how do I know what abnormal is if I don't know what normal is? Like, I didn't really even understand this whole system for checking your cervical mucus and things because they tell you absolutely nothing. So just, I think this needs to be a general course for somebody, that for everybody, I think even guys could help just knowing how people's bodies work too. I think everybody just needs to know how the human body works on a basic level so that you can know what your health is telling you, what your body's telling you.
Well, I mean, it's so interesting because on the one hand, yes, we can go into all kinds of complexity and detail and research and studies. So I like to hold both realities in my hand. So yes, there's a lot of complexity we could dive into. But on the other hand, when you're charting your cycles, after you've kind of dove in and you figure out the basics of mucus and temperature and cervical position, et cetera, it's pretty straightforward because when you're cycling, you're cycling. So you have a cycle and you have another one and you have another one. And, you know, 20 years later, you have a couple thousand of them. So you kind of get the gist, like it kind of makes sense. And it's something that is repeatable and it continues to happen. So it's not that difficult to understand. So I've already made peace with the fact that our health care / educational system, if they decide to implement something like this, I don't know, it certainly doesn't seem to be a priority. No. Even with all the increasing attention that periods have been getting and et cetera, I still feel like we're not there. So we don't need to wait for them to decide it's important.
Exactly. No, that's what kind of drove me down this path. And I'm still figuring out like what I want to do in the world, basically. But I want to do some sort of education like this for people because I think everything I've found that's so beautiful, all these books are great. And there's so much information from all these, some are doctors and practitioners, or some are just like women, like Elisa Vitti was like, just had PCOS, had to figure it out on her own. And so she's sharing, but all the things they've created are really for women who are now suffering from something and then saying, well, what can I do to fix it? So it's like, we've all gotten here to this part of suffering and now we're going to help each other. But I think I want to find a way to go beforehand and say, like, okay, let's teach you early on what's going on. So then you can stop yourself from going down that path. And I do think it's going to be more of these like little classes that you have to kind of just spread in your own area and get the word out there. But yeah, the traditional system isn't set up to like take that on at the time. And I just think it's so helpful that I just want everyone to know this. Like every book I read, I was just like, this is life-changing. Everyone should know this. Like I didn't know until I guess a year ago, starting reading these books, that your uterus moves. Like it moves. I was like, I looked around, I was like, no one's there but the dog. And I'm just looking around like, your uterus moves. Like, why don't we know this? Like, it's just fabulous that it's fabulous what we weren't taught, but the body is really beautiful and it can do so many wonderful things.
Well, and on the one hand, it's like, it's kind of just like, this is interesting. This is empowering. I should just understand it. But on the other hand, it makes me think of a little bit about the last conversation that we had in our group when I was, you know, talking about finding healthcare, finding doctors and choosing doctors and things like that, because one of the big challenges and the reason why there's such a need for this is because, you know, it would appear as though the medical system was designed for men, you know, by men for men. And it would appear as though when women try to seek medical care for menstrual cycle or fertility related issues, they're basically given the pill, painkillers or IVF, right? Like IVF drugs, that's it. And so a lot of these modalities are not designed to get to the root cause of our specific types of issues. So on the one hand, it's this nice to know so many of us are like, this is amazing. This is fun. This is incredible. And I wish everyone would learn this. But on the other hand, it has such serious applications for some of the most intimate and kind of intensely personal and meaningful aspects of our life. So our reproductive function, that's how we have babies. That's how we make our families. It's really important. It's how we're intimate with our partners. And having a terrible experience and not being able to find support is just, it's horrifying because it's such a deeply intimate part of our lives. So yeah, we just do what we can, I think, at this stage to share the information. I think that's why so many books are coming out. So many women are jumping into these fields because we really just want other women not to have to go through this. Cause it's like, why? Like, I wouldn't wish this on my worst enemy. Like, why would you have to go through so much like trauma just to get care for a bit? And it's basic, the irony, because what we talked about in the class, I was reading, I don't know why I did this to myself, but I was reading some reviews, some book reviews. I don't remember why. I kind of fell down a rabbit hole yesterday and I was doing some research, but I ended up I was reading reviews. And one of the comments, it was not like a positive comment, but one of the comments was like, it's just like overstated. The diet can't fix everything. It's just like, it was kind of one of those things. Like, the book is too simple. It just overstates the value of diet. Diet can't fix everything. And of course, I don't think diet can fix everything, quote unquote. But often some of the most challenging issues that we have with our cycle can be dramatically improved if we just get basic support for the foundational factors that are essential for normal menstrual cycle function. Literally another hill I'll die on. And if it gets annoying, me talking about it, and if it gets annoying, talking about the importance of sleep and eating well and moving well and all in balance with our cycle, I'm okay with that. Because, like, for example, like when you go to your doctor with period issues, are they telling you any of that?
Not at all. No, you say you're going to die on the hill. I'll be on that little hill next to you. So don't worry, because
we'll do it there together.
Because I agree that it's just, when I was reading the books, I was getting angry because I was like, how do they not know this? And, you know, you go back to that whole, you were saying it, which makes sense. Like, they were not taught in medical school to do the holistic approach, to find the root cause, to, you know, go this whole long route. Basically, it's just, here's the quick fix, here's the pill. But I'm like, as a woman, that's probably usually they're older than me, at least like 40, had a kid or something. I was like, you're at that stage of your life. And I'm like, do you even understand how the menstrual cycle works? Like the follicular phase, the ovulatory phase, the luteal phase, do you even get that that's all there? And that like ovulation is helpful for our overall health? Cause I'm like, you're a doctor and you're a woman and you're older than me. I'm like, at least just having those facts, I feel like would help you in your medical practice. Like, wouldn't you want to pick up a book? Like, if your job is to work with women and hormones, wouldn't you want to pick up a book called The Fifth Vital Sign that was recently written and just breeze through it and just say, maybe I could learn something from here? I'm like, I just was blown away. And I don't know, I could go there forever, but I do think it's good that people can empower themselves and they can decide what their team is. That's a big thing I think I took away from today's class. And it's been reiterated in my life that your medical care, you get to choose it. You get to choose your car. You get to choose your hairdresser. You get to choose your medical team. So if you're not happy with them, or if they don't mesh with you on your current thought process, again, maybe you were always on the same thought process with them, but now you listen to this and you want to change it. It's okay to change your opinion. Now you bring it to them, see what they say. And if they don't agree or don't give you any room to kind of have this differing opinion, then you can go and see if there's someone else who will work with you on that level. So it's nice to just empower yourself, have the information, and then know that this one person is not the end all be all to your healthcare. And I like that.
Mm-hmm. I feel like this conversation is just really helpful and needed, and just to kind of go there in all those different areas and to speak to something that you said, because you said, you know, if I was a medical doctor and this was my field, wouldn't it make sense for me to look to certain resources? So that's an interesting thought, because for some medical professionals, absolutely. Because I think that what happens, you know, just from doing interviews and stuff like that, is often people will have that very personal experience where they're in a field, they've been trained in a certain way. The medical field is very dogmatic, in case anyone doesn't know. And so you're trained in a very specific way, to the point where some healthcare professionals come out of their training believing that anyone who doesn't do what I do is basically full of it. Now, not all medical professionals feel that way, right? But there is a certain degree of like, well, that person is doing that type of thing, and that person is doing that type of thing, and that's not as valid as what I'm doing. And so some medical professionals might find themselves in a personal health crisis where they end up having to kind of like, their medicine doesn't necessarily yield the results that they're looking for. And so they have to go outside of that, and they have an experience, and then that informs their practice. So I've certainly done a lot of interviews with health professionals who've had that. Either they had a close friend or family member who had a health crisis, who then had to go outside of the system, air quotes, to get care, or they themselves had an issue. It makes me think of an episode I did with a medical doctor, and she, I believe she came off the pill and she just didn't get her period back for like 5 years. And so she had to like figure this out because she did all the medical stuff and it wasn't giving her the results that she was looking for. And so that has then allowed her to look outside of it. So that's something I think is really important to remember, because this isn't about bashing medical professionals, but it's about understanding where they're coming from, their framework, their views, how they look at the world, how they look at illness. How a person looks at illness is going to have an impact on how you're treated. If you look at illness like a symptom that needs to be squashed, like a irregular period that just needs to be regulated with a pill, you're going to get different care than if someone looks at that same exact symptom as a sign of a potential metabolic issue. Like, these two things are very different, and therefore the approaches are very different. So my hope with all of the work that I do, with the classes, with the podcast, is just to kind of expose people to a different way of thinking. Because ultimately, when we are sick, when we need help, when we have an issue, we often need more than one person on our team. We often need to try a different modality sometimes. Just as a...
No, I agree. And that's what I loved about this whole, like, my journey. I call it like my health journey, basically. And I've learned that I like to say, if it's connected, it's affected. So everything's connected. So if you give a pill to your body and they're like, oh, well, this pill is for your heart, or this pill is just for your ovulation so that you don't have any period, right? It's just to control your birth control. Well, it's not, because it's going in your mouth, and your mouth is connected to everything. And so it's in your body everywhere. So it's not just going to affect your hormones in that way. It'll affect everything. So just having the understanding of like, wow, everything is affected here. So if I have a symptom that's completely in a different area, it's still my body, and it still could be coming from this pill, or it could be coming from stress or whatever it is, just knowing that your whole body is connected. So I found that very, very helpful to just know it's time to look at everything as a whole.
Mm-hmm. Well, I could keep talking to you, because this is like super fun, but at some point we'll have to go for the day. But for a woman who's listening, who is on the pill, or who's recently come off, or who is still debating, you know, if she's ready to come off, what, if anything, would you want her to know if she's trying to make that decision?
That's a great question. Because I do have a lot of people in my life that I toe around how much I can say to, because I don't ever want to be the reason that somebody feels that they aren't doing something correctly, or that they have to do this or that. It is your choice. It is your body. You always have that option. I think the pill has been great for many reasons for many people. And even if I knew what I know now back 10 years ago, I can't tell you that I would definitely come off the pill right away. I don't know. I might have still said, wow, that's great to know, but I'll just carry on for a little longer. So I think it's just great to know that being on any medicine, especially this one, over a long period of time can have compounding effects that you don't know what they're going to look like for you, because it's going to be very different. Like I said, if it's connected, it's affected. So it could be a stomach thing. It can be an acne thing. It can be a hormone thing, whatever. You don't know. And so just knowing, okay, by every day taking this pill, I am unaware that it could be affecting my body in some way. So let me just keep paying attention to what my body is telling me. So I think awareness is like the biggest thing I try and teach people. I teach yoga, but it's the more aware you can be, then the more present you are in the moment and the more information you have. So it's just constantly understanding your information. So bringing awareness to yourself and just educating yourself. If you hear this podcast and it's the first time, just saying, wow, that was interesting. Let me just dive a little deeper. Let me get this one book. Let me listen to this other podcast, just so you know what is going into your body. And that's the same for any medicine, food, anything that's going into your body, even human interaction, people around you can be toxic. So just taking in what you take in every day and being aware of that environment. So I just think it's good to know what you're doing. But it is your decision, and we support you, whatever that is. I don't think you're ever doomed. I think you can always come out of it, no matter how far down the rabbit hole you've gone. There's always a solution. Your body is always trying to keep you alive and keep you healthy, and that's so beautiful. So all you have to do is work with your body, and you'll start to see good results. So we are here for you. We support you, and I just want everyone to be happy living in their body, because it's the only one you got.
I love that. It's so important to remember how resilient the body is, because it's a hard line to toe when you talk about the downsides of things. And because some women on the other end of it think, oh my goodness, I've been on the pill for 15 years. I destroyed myself. And nope, you know, no, the body's really, really resilient. You may go through a transitional period. And I feel like that's what I try to shed light on. You know, there's this transitional period. And if you're trying to get pregnant, right, if it's a different reason you're coming off and you're coming off to start your family, it's helpful to know about that transitional period because that can help you to plan better. But yes, there's always hope. Our bodies are really amazing and very, very resilient. And last question for you, for anyone who is thinking about joining the Fertility Awareness Mastery Group program, and they're kind of wondering what it's really like in there. Is it weird to be on Zoom with a bunch of strangers? Initially, they're not strangers for long, but what, if anything, would you want them to know?
I think if you're thinking about it and this sounds interesting to you, that there's no reason you shouldn't do it, because it's just a beautiful group of people. And all, I mean, it can be anywhere. If you know anything about charting, if you know absolutely nothing, if you don't even know what the follicular phase is, it doesn't matter, because she has so many great tools for you. And it's such a welcoming environment. It's just going to give you the information that you need to understand your body for the rest of your life, to give you health and happiness for the rest of your life. So I just think it's information that is just, you need this information. So read the book, because the book's great. But if you really want to put it into your life and use it, then having an actual facilitator, a teacher, is really, really helpful. So I couldn't recommend it more highly.
Oh, thanks, Meg. That's so nice. Okay. Well, thank you so much for being here. I'm so glad that we were able to have this additional chat. And I really loved our conversation. I feel like this is going to be just an interesting podcast for the listeners, because we just kind of went for it and talked about all kinds of different topics with the ultimate end goal of just empowering ourselves.
I love it. That's what I love about it, is information and knowing yourself, and just keep going, because you're doing great. And your podcast keeps me going. So thank you so much for having me. I love it, and keep sharing it.
Thank you for listening. If you enjoyed today's show, please share it with a friend. You'll find the show notes page for today's episode over at fertilityfriday.com/381. I hope that you enjoyed today's interview with Meg. It was such a treat to have her on the show. And I feel like our conversation, we just kind of naturally went to different topics and different areas and just shared a lot of important insights. And that's one of the things I love about this podcast, because we just get to explore these topics that you just don't really talk about a lot. I mean, I talk about them a lot. So I know that sometimes I'll hear a client tell me something like, oh, I had my something happened and all of a sudden the podcast started blaring on my phone and I was in my office. And I kind of remember that this isn't something that most of us are talking about. So I've done my best to create a space, both with podcasts, social media, and also in my, you know, in my more private programs, for us to really have these conversations about the menstrual cycle. And I know a lot of my clients have commented that because, you know, the podcast is kind of inspiring them in a lot of different ways, they do end up having these conversations with their girlfriends and talking about periods, menstrual cycles, cervical fluid, fertility awareness, the whole gamut. So yeah, so it's always fun having these conversations. And I always love creating a space for them. If we were to ever cross paths in person, I am not shy to talk about this stuff, regardless of what's happening. And what I find interesting is that you would logically think that a lot of men would be made really uncomfortable. Some of them are, but the majority of the men that have the interesting fortune of coming across me and then, you know, asking me what I do, often they're really intrigued about it, because most, if not all, men have women in their lives, whether it be, you know, a sibling, a cousin, a partner, a sister, you know, whatever the case is. So I'm rambling, so I'm going to stop rambling. But I hope you have a wonderful weekend whenever you tune into the show. And just a quick reminder that if you are wanting to dive deeper into this yourself, if you're ready to make that transition and start really relying on fertility awareness for birth control, or if you've been trying to get pregnant and you're really wanting to get some insights into what you can learn from your cycle to really optimize your chances of conceiving naturally, make sure to join us in the upcoming Fertility Awareness Mastery Live group program. We're starting in a couple of weeks. And you can find all the details and register over at fertilityfriday.com/fam. That's fertilityfriday.com/FAM. So with that said, have a wonderful weekend whenever you're tuning into the show. And of course, as always, until next time, be well and happy charting.